We exalt and we rejoice that He has saved us. The word of the Lord.
I have called you as you. Since the foundation of the
world. Alleluia.
Allow me, dear friends, to share a few thoughts on how the thought that the son he's bearing today might have been one of his forebears. And then, for those of you who knew him well and loved him, as one of you said, referring to a whole continent, not just a whole continent. The depth of my love for him. And this Philipson was one of the three boys, Philbert and Philip, their brothers, his brothers, who lived next door to my family house in Hayfield. So I've known them for a long time. And I remember, not many years, last year, but their father is still with us, and he's here today. So Mr. B, thank you for your three sons and the love that you've shown them. Thank you for giving us a special an occasion of the passing of his son. And one of the things he said to me was, Father, I thought he would have been one of my forebears. And here it is, I have to bury him today. He said that in a certain way, but he said that with a certain stressing, I suppose, a heartfelt emotion, which I think many parents feel. That most parents feel that their children will bury them, not the other way around. And so to you, Mr. B, and to the rest of the family, today is a day that I suppose you'll never forget. But I suppose today is a day to thank God for who you are and the way you grow for your children. To you, Connie, and the children, what can I say? Except that you just look around and see how many of them. What can we say? Even with social distancing, the church is full. What can we say? That you too are loved by all of us. We care for you, and we're praying with you today as we say farewell to your beloved husband. Dear friends, I began by saying, and regardless of how many funerals I've done, each one is particular, each one is different. And yet, I'm here not to speak so much of death, but to speak of life. The life that we live now, and the life that we look forward to, and the resurrection of the dead. And so I go back to Mr. B's words. Mr. Bertrand said to me, "Father, I thought he would have been one of my pallbearers, but no, I have to bury him." And what this says to me, my dear friends, is none of us understands life really. We go through life on its own. We live each day as if there will be another day. Tomorrow I will do this. And yet the reality is none of us knows if there will be a tomorrow for any of us. That's a fact. And so when Mr. Bertrand said that to me, I said, "You see how life is?" At 82 or 83, he thought he would be burying his son, burying him, but there he is now burying his son at 49. It's something, my dear friends, that each of us needs to think about. That we don't know the day nor the hour. Life is what it is. The time is now. And somehow we have to make the best of it and be the best we can be. Because tomorrow doesn't belong to any of us. And that is why we take time to come to a moment like this. I believe that many people come to funerals, not only because they knew the individual who has passed away, but because consciously or unconsciously, they recognize their own mortality. They recognize that one day I will die. And that is a fact. One day I will die. One day you will die. And because none of us knows the day nor the hour, then we say, "Lord, let me use each day well. Let me make each day count. Not only to gratify myself, but somehow to make a difference in the life of another. To make a difference in my community, in my world. And to make a difference that is memorable, and most of all, that is positive, that is good." And the faith we have, my dear friends, reminds us that the love that God has for us is beyond our understanding. You heard the second reading today from Paul the Romans. If God is on our side, who can be against us? And that should somehow drive us each day as we face the very different challenges of life, that somehow God is with me. And if he acquits, no one can condemn. Oh yes, I'm not perfect, but I'm good. Good enough that my God would die for me. That he was infused with his Holy Spirit. That he would give me wisdom and understanding and all the gifts to move on, to carry on. And that is why, my dear friends, today, we've chosen all these readings that the family chose. First reading from Isaiah. "On this mountain, the Lord will set a banquet of rich food and plenty. The Lord is there waiting, setting the table for you and me. And ours is to say, I want to be ready when that day comes. I don't want anybody else to take my place. I want to ensure that I'm there to rejoice and to enjoy all that rich food and drink all that rich wine that God has prepared for me. And the way I prepare comes down to what we heard in the gospel reading, the Beatitude. How blessed are the poor in spirit. How blessed are the meek. How blessed are those who mourn. thou art merciful. All those Beatitudes remind us of the things that we need to put in place so that we can be sure that when the time for the banquet comes, we will be there. When the banquet is ready, maybe you would leave, you would die. And our place at the banquet, although it's reserved, will be filled by us. If all of you understand all these things that we speak about today, how blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Today there's not a mourning the death of Philipson. But I invite you, dear friends, to mourn for more than that. Mourn more than that. Mourn, for example, the injustices that are occurring in our world today. All those things that are wrong, where people are not treated as people but as things. All those things that are wrong, where wives and husbands don't agree, where we somehow hurt the very ones that we love the most. All those things that are wrong, where our children don't have a life of childhood. That should be reminded us, let the children be children. They grow up too fast. They're abused. To mourn all those things, somehow our hearts pound with pain when we see or hear these things. But today we mourn the passing of the Messiah. And the Lord says, one day you will be comforted. And we pray that that one day has already begun. That one day is not somehow far in the distant future. It is already here because we are making it happen. We are trying to dry the tears of each other. We are the ones looking out for one another, making sure that when there is injustice, we stand up for the other. That one day is already here. And so the three boys grew, and today we bury one of them. Four. The fourth one, sorry. And today we bury one of them. Mr. B, you still have him. And you still have us. You still have the records. So as we gather today, my dear friends, to bury Philipson, that all these things somehow turn in our hearts and our spirits. What it is we do today, the significance of it. The fact that we lose someone who's dear to us is big. Sometimes nobody knows how big it is, but we know how big it is. But I go back to our faith that reminds us that no matter how big our pain, no matter how big our suffering, our God never abandons us. Our God never leaves us alone, and He will be with us until the end. So, Philipson, go on to the Lord. We love you, but we must let you go. We ask you to remember us when you meet the Lord, and know that you will be with you as well. And we all look forward to see you again someday. Eternal rest grant unto him, O Lord. Let the precious light shine upon him. May he rest in peace. May his soul and the soul of all the faithful depart through the mercy of God. Rest in peace. Amen. Let us stand, dear friends, and together let us offer our prayers for all the dead, but in particular for our brother Philip. thank you for our brother. We ask you please to hear our prayers on his behalf and for those of whom we pray. Lord God, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer Jesus Christ and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ and grant them a place in the kingdom. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Oh, be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we humbly present to you these sacrificial offerings, O Lord, for the salvation of your servant Philipson, we beseech your mercy that he who did not doubt you well and ever. Amen. Thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, for those saddened by the certainty of dying might be convinced this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so, with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominion, with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end. With the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and we praise and glorify you through your Son.
In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
My Savior, Spirit, lead me when my
Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that your servant Philipson, who today has journeyed from this world, may by this sacrifice be cleansed and freed from sin. And so receive. I join Father Letar, Father Francis, and Deacon Paul in expressing our sincere sympathy to you, family and friends.
Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother Philipson. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope, voice, even death itself. Into your hands we commend our brother Philipson, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant, and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith. Until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. Go in the peace of Christ. Thank Karim to remind you that the happy hour is cancelled. So there's no happy hour. So please, after interment, go out your mother home.
Dear friends, this concludes the celebration here at the church. Please join us if you can in procession to the cemetery, where we shall have the final means of prayer at the graveside. Please allow the ministers to exit first, followed by the deceased, followed by the members of the family, and then the rest of you who will accompany us to the cemetery. Please join in singing our recessional hymn as it is printed in the open text.